Greetings, crew believers, and welcome to another Invincible episode of History of the Marvel Universe. Today's tale begins in South Philadelphia, where James Rhodes, or Rhodey, was born and raised. Growing up in a poor neighborhood, James was often the victim of bullying and violence. As he grew older, he became more determined to stand up to such bullies. Although his actions landed him in juvenile detention more than once, he began fighting for those who couldn't defend themselves. It was this determination that led James to becoming a Marine. He served several tours in Southeast Asia during the Sin Kang War. During this time, he also studied to become an aviation engineer and served as a helicopter pilot. And on one mission, his chopper was badly damaged, forcing him to land in the jungle. While Rhodes was inspecting the damage to his helicopter, a strange armored figure emerged from the foliage. This was the Invincible Iron Man, secretly the American industrialist Tony Stark. After being injured and imprisoned by the guerrilla warlord Wang Chu, Stark built his life-saving armor with the help of a Chinese scientist named Ho Yinsen. Yinsen sacrificed himself to distract Wang Chu's forces long enough for the armor to fully power up. Stark then defeated the warlord, destroying his camp and escaping into the jungle. And that's where James Rhodes and Iron Man first met, only to both be attacked by more Sin Kang guerrillas. After the two men drove off the enemy soldiers, Rhodey allowed Iron Man to use his helicopter's battery to recharge his armored chest plate, as it was the only thing keeping his heart beating at the time. After trekking through the jungle for some time, Iron Man and Rhodes stumbled across an enemy encampment. They routed the Sin Kang forces and stole their helicopter, using it to escape to an American base. After this, Rhodey was approached by Tony Stark, claiming to be Iron Man's employer, who offered him a job as a pilot once his tour of duty was finished. And sure enough, Rhodey agreed, and over time, the two men became close friends. While Stark continued to operate as Iron Man, iterating on his armor several times and becoming a founding member of the Avengers, the combined stress of superheroics and that of running a multinational company began to take its toll. And so, Rhodey was forced to watch as Tony slowly turned to alcoholism. After going into battle against the supervillain Magma while intoxicated, Iron Man suffered an embarrassing defeat and retreated. Tony revealed his dual identity to Rhodey, who was unsurprised, having already suspected such a thing. When Tony, in his drunken stupor, was unable to go into battle once more, James Rhodes took it upon himself to don the armor himself and assume the mantle of Iron Man. After Rhodey proved himself by defeating Magma, Stark insisted that he keep the armor and continue to fill in for him. While Rhodey's combat experience served him well as Iron Man, for repair and upkeep of the armor, he turned to the scientist siblings of Morwin and Clymenestra Irwin. However, he soon began suffering from terrible headaches after using the armor. Meanwhile, as Tony continued to struggle with his alcoholism, his company underwent a corporate takeover at the hands of his business rival Obadiah Stane. Things spiraled out of control from there and eventually got so bad that Tony wound up depressed and destitute. During this time, he also befriended and grew close to another alcoholic, a pregnant woman named Gretel. Things finally came to a head when Tony and Gretel were trapped outside during a blizzard overnight, on the night that Gretel gave birth. While Gretel passed away in his arms, Tony was able to keep the baby warm and alive until they were found the next morning. Tony was hospitalized, but he finally agreed to stop drinking and admitted to Rhodey that he needed help. While Tony was recovering, he, Rhodey, and the Irwin twins all moved to California to start their new electronics company, Circuits Maximus. However, Rhodey's headaches continued to worsen, making him more irritable and more hostile towards his friends, especially Tony. When Tony learned this, he realized that the armor's cybernetic interface was custom-built for his own brain patterns and hadn't been recalibrated for Rhodey. However, even after Tony made the proper adjustments, the headaches persisted, and Rhodey kept them secret, growing paranoid that Tony would take the armor back. Tony, as it turns out, had no interest in returning to the role of Iron Man, but he did keep his idle hands busy by slowly building a new suit based on his very first design. However, when the mounting tension finally boiled over, Tony was forced to don his rebuilt armor and confront his friend. This confrontation ended when Tony shut down Rhodey's armor before removing his own, leaving himself vulnerable. The unarmed Tony Stark then reactivated Jim Rhodes' armor, fully trusting his friend not to hurt him. And so, Tony and Rhodey made amends, and for a time, there were two Iron Men. And after this, with the help of the Canadian mystic, Shaman, Rhodey was able to confront his fears and insecurity, ridding himself of the headaches and the hostility that plagued him. With both men having faced their demons and restoring their friendship, Tony and Rhodey went into battle together when Obadiah Stane sent his mechanical drones to attack Circuits Maximus. While they were victorious, Tony's armor was badly damaged during the battle. Worse yet, sometime later, Obadiah Stane sent a package to Circuits Maximus, which exploded, destroying the building, injuring Rhodey and Clemenestra, and killing Morley Irwin. Donning a new suit of armor he'd been working on, Tony Stark went to confront Obadiah Stane. However, Stane had built a suit of his own, the Iron Monger armor. Stane pulled every dirty trick he could, but Tony fought him to a standstill. And at the end of the battle, when everything he'd built had fallen into ruin, Obadiah Stane succumbed to his own madness and turned the Ironmonger's weapons on himself. After this, Tony resumed the role of Iron Man while Rhodey would sometimes back him up with his own armor. However, he found himself reluctant to do so after he was badly burned while wearing the suit and Jim Rhodes retired from being Iron Man. Fortunately, Jim recovered and the two remained friends with Rhodey at Tony's side when he started his new company, Stark Enterprises. Following this, Tony constructed several new suits, including the most heavily armed version yet, the War Machine. However, Stark had to step aside once more after he was injured and infected with a techno-organic virus. He was placed into cryogenic suspension until a cure could be found and his body repaired. However, to keep himself safe from further attack during that time, he faked his death, and only the few scientists working on the project knew that he was alive. Tony once again left the role of Iron Man to Jim Rhodes, this time along with control of his company. Rhodey was reluctant, but begrudgingly accepted that the world still needed an Iron Man. However, when Stark returned, his deception put a serious strain on their relationship. While Rhodey wanted nothing to do with Stark, Tony insisted that his friend keep the War Machine armor. And as angry as Rhodey was, he knew that Tony was right. He still wanted to be a hero. And so, James Rhodes took the suit and its name to become War Machine, a hero in his own right and another mighty warrior in the never-ending battle against evil and injustice. And that is the origin of War Machine. But thank you so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, please leave a like, share the video, and subscribe for more marvelous content. Be sure to leave a comment letting me know what Marvel hero or villain you want to hear about next, and as always, the issues referenced in this video are listed in the description below, as well as links to other places you can find me. So until next time, true believers, Excelsior!